Burma is essentially run by one of the world's most lauded humanitarians, a Nobel Peace Prize laureate and a democracy icon. Aung San Suu Kyi, who leads the party in charge of the government, suffered more than two decades of repression, including a long house arrest, rather than leave the country or abandon her quest for elections. Yet since her party took power last year, Suu Kyi, the country's de facto leader, though not its official president, has stood by and watched the slaughter and flight of hundreds of thousands of ethnic Rohingya, a Muslim minority more than a million strong. In 2016, Burma's military was engaged in a campaign of brutal suppression in Rakhine State, in the west of the country. Then, scattered attacks by Rohingya militant groups on police posts prompted an even harsher counterattack from the generals, reportedly joined by vigilante groups and other state security forces. That cycle intensified further this summer. Human Rights Watch, Amnesty International and other monitors have cited expulsions of Rohingya from towns, campaigns to burn whole villages and killings by the armed forces in Burma, which is also called Myanmar. In recent weeks alone, some 370,000 Rohingya have fled into Bangladesh, according to United Nations estimates. The UN Rights Chief calls the campaign in Rakhine a textbook example of ethnic cleansing. NPR noted that reports of unbridled murder and arson, rape and persecution have followed Rohingya out of Myanmar's western state of Rakhine, sketching a stark portrait of government violence. Suu Kyi, whose National League for Democracy party was also repressed and brutalized by the armed forces during the long era of military rule, refuses to look squarely at the crisis. She has yet to visit the center of the violence, and in her public comments, she has refrained from criticizing the armed forces. This month, she claimed that there was an iceberg of misinformation circulating about the situation in Rakhine. Her office has mocked supposed fake news about the plight of the Rohingya. And her spokesman told local news outlet Frontier Myanmar that Rohingya are holding weapons, swords, daggers, catapults and homemade rifles, and then seemed to give non-Rohingya carte blanche to shoot Rohingya if they perceived danger from them. Why did somebody who achieved so much good become complicit in so much ugliness? There are several possible, interlocking reasons. First, Suu Kyi's current silence is consistent with her approach to the Rohingya for years. She has never demonstrated much sympathy. On the campaign trail before the November 2015 election, she strove to avoid discussing violence in Rakhine, even though an earlier wave had destroyed Rohingya communities and no militant group had yet emerged there. When she did speak about the Rohingya, she called reporters into a news conference shortly before the vote and told them not to exaggerate the difficulties that the Rohingya face. It's possible that this disinterest reflects Suu Kyi's personal views, but it's impossible to know for sure. One of her best-known biographers, Peter Popham, has written that Suu Kyi is not, at her core, a bigot. She has had senior advisors who are Muslims, although not Rohingya. And one of the key figures in persuading her to dive into the democracy movement was a best-selling dissident Muslim author, Muang Tha Ka, Popham notes. But Suu Kyi does represent her party. And there was little concern among the NLD rank and file in 2015, or even now in 2017, about violence against the Rohingya. Many NLD members, like a significant share of the Buddhist majority, simply think that the Rohingya are outsiders, called Bengalis by many Burmese, who do not deserve to live in the country, even though some have been there for generations. Last year, Suu Kyi reportedly asked the U.S. ambassador in Burma not to refer to the group as Rohingya, a sign that she sees them this way, too. That means there is no political benefit to challenging majority views toward the Rohingya. The NLD did not put up any Muslim candidates during the 2015 national elections. Other former pro-democracy leaders, who also were harshly repressed by the military during the decades of junta rule, have expressed far stronger anti-Rohingya sentiments than Suu Kyi ever has. These sentiments coincide with a growing Buddhist nationalist movement. As a recent international crisis group investigation revealed, this political and social movement is building extensive services at the community level. Buddhist nationalist groups offer what the ICG calls a sense of belonging for many young Buddhists. Such groups are the type of grassroots organizations that no politician likes to alienate. Suu Kyi does not depend on the movement's support. Many hardline Buddhist nationalists view her as soft on the Rohingya, but she also probably does not want a major rift with it. Since taking control of the government, At Lee.